Greetings. Owner Dogen, I hope you gave part one some serious thought. You responded with the following. Dear Texas, you responded well against my claim, but you didn't mention that Paul abolished the law with his teachings. That's clearly satanic. I'll answer this first, then continue with the rest of your post, brother. Paul abolished the law with his teachings. That's clearly satanic. I think you misunderstand nearly everything about Paul. I think you should first go rewatch the previous video, because Jesus called Paul for the specific revelation Jesus gave Paul to teach. Recall the whole blinding light and the duet of Paul and Ananias of Damascus. But I think your basic understanding is simply undeveloped, brother. You were told Jesus taught the law and only the law and follow the law. But that is not a clear understanding of the situation, brother. Jesus said he came to fulfill the law. If it is fulfilled, it may be a completed contract. Matthew 5:17. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them, Jesus said. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Jesus taught that the word of God would not pass away, could not be changed by men. When Islam claims the Torah and Bible are changed and corrupted, they implicitly contradict Jesus, calling him wrong, and a fool or a liar. While Jesus was on earth, Jesus' disciples broke various traditions. Matthew 15:2. Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They do not wash their hands when they eat. Jesus replied, and why do you break the command of God for the sake of your tradition? Jesus gave new laws or commandments. John 13:34. A new commandment I give to you, that you should love one another. As I have loved you, so you also should love one another. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I loved you. Jesus gave other, more stringent requirements. Matthew 6:21. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, you fool, will be liable to the hell of fire. Matthew 6:27. You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Jesus' disciples did not fast, and not behind Jesus' back so that he was just unaware. He knew. Matthew 9:14. Then the disciples of John came to him asking, why do we and the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, the attendants of the bridegroom cannot mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them, can they? But the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast. Jesus knew they were not fasting, and probably told them to not fast yet, but he confirmed they would in the future. Jesus established a new covenant with his blood and his body, dying on the cross. Luke 22:20. In the same way, after supper, he, meaning Jesus, took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. The new covenant fulfilled the promise given through the prophets in their message. Jeremiah 31:31. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, Yahweh, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. So, brother, because you do not know what Jesus taught and did, you form incorrect judgments against Paul. Just as the Lord Jesus revealed the meeting with Ananias to Paul, the Lord taught Paul what to teach. 1 Corinthians 11:23, "For I received from the Lord," that's a direct communication, "that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus in the night in which he was betrayed took bread." "For I received from the Lord" means that Jesus taught this directly to Paul. "And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Paul taught the things Jesus wanted Paul to teach, brother. After Paul was healed, as Jesus showing Ananias doing, Paul was a changed man. Acts 9:20, Saul promptly began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogues, declaring, "He is the Son of God." Paul himself said he only taught what was in the scriptures. Acts 17:2, and according to Paul's custom, he went to them and for three Sabbaths reasoned with them from the scriptures. Acts 24:14, "But this I confess to you, that according to the way which they call a sect, so I worship the Elohim or God of my fathers, believing all things which are written in the law and in the prophets." Paul himself said he did not abolish the law. Romans 3:31, "Do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law." Paul taught how Jesus fulfilled the message of the prophets, brother. I recommend you watch my video series, The Message of the Prophets. If you will not watch the whole series, please watch part 5 and learn which prophets foretold Jesus is God. The list is even longer, brother, of scriptures I could find that prove Paul's message is correct and aligned with the message of the prophets. This is a lifelong study of the message God has revealed in the earth, brother. Clearly, Paul did not see Satan, the angel of light, nor was the message taught by Paul satanic. Paul was a man educated in the scriptures. Acts 22:3, "I am a Jew, born in Tarsus of Cilicia, but raised in this city. I was educated at the feet of Gamaliel, in strict conformity to the law of our fathers. I am just as zealous for God as any of you here today." Philippians 3:5, "Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, an Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee." And it was this education that allowed and equipped Paul to teach the revelation and prove from the scriptures that Jesus is God in the flesh. Beyond that, brother, God endorsed Paul by working miracles. Acts 19:11, God was performing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul, so that handkerchiefs or aprons were even carried from his body to the sick, and the diseases left them and the evil spirits went out. Does not Islam and the Quran teach you the miracles are with Allah? Is this not the excuse Muhammad raised when he was challenged to prove his prophethood? Paul's message was not satanic, brother, because God endorsed Paul by working miracles. You then continued your message with another set of comments. You wrote, "On the other side, Muhammad, peace be upon him, taught us to be righteous Gentiles and to follow the law God gave us." There is no gentle way to say this, brother. That is simply false. First and most glaring, God did not give you the law or anything else. Muhammad claimed a spirit named Jibril, who no one ever saw, gave him a book that Muhammad could not read, from a spirit named Allah that Muhammad never saw. Second, Muhammad did not teach righteousness. Muhammad taught obedience to him. Surah 465 from the Sayyid Ahmad translation. But no, by your Lord, they can have no real faith, meaning you can't be Muslim unless they make you, Muhammad, judge in all disputes between them and find no objections in their souls against your, Muhammad's, decisions. But accept them, Muhammad's decisions, with the fullest submission or conviction or surrender. You cannot follow Islam. You cannot be a Muslim unless you obey Muhammad. That is not teaching you to be righteous, brother. It is conditioning you to be useful and obedient. But Muhammad is dead and gone, and still Islam conditions you to be useful and obedient to something. Sadly, that something is not the God of the prophets, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And the conditioning is absolutely revealed in those most committed to Muhammad's religion and teachings. Brother Onur, I believe you are sincere in your commitment to obey Muhammad and to please your Allah. But I know that you are following a false path when you follow Islam and Muhammad's Quran. You wrote, and Jews agree and say that we will go to heaven through Islam, but in hell through Christianity. There are several aspects wrong with this line of reasoning, brother. The main being that you are cherry-picking the issue where you will demur to Jewish authority. The Jews also claim eternal ownership of Israel and Jerusalem, which I happen to agree with. Is that Jewish position also the final authoritative word on that issue, which you will accept and swear to? Does Islam seek to offer and accept Jewish control of the Temple Mount and a new temple? Second, is the very real possibility of passive-aggressive damnation of the evil hell-bent jihadis fighting against the Jewish people. If one has the truth and one knows the truth, then one only has to deny the truth, keep it from those one hates. I certainly do not wish to malign the Jewish individuals you claim who nod to Islam's virtue and salvific value. After all, since Islam claims Jews corrupted the Torah, how do you rationally trust their judgment on any issue, brother? How then do you think it rational to appeal to their authority in your jihad against Christianity and the Apostle Paul? You are not winning any points or changing any minds with this fallacious argument line, brother. You wrote, you know they call Muslims B'nai Noah, and they say that only Muslims have the same God as them. Some may say that, and they are simply wrong. Human beings are often wrong about issues. In fact, the Jewish people have been wrong, blind, to Yeshua the Messiah. So if you respected their argument, you would call Islam wrong for thinking Jesus was the Messiah. But if you can find a rabbi who says Yeshua is the Messiah, give the rest of what he says a fair hearing too. You wrote, the facts of the teachings are important and have to be consistent with Judaism. While your interpretation of your own argument is flawed, brother, I totally agree with you. And Christianity is totally coherent with the Old Testament and the message of the prophets. It may be at odds with Rabbinic Talmudic Judaism, but that is not the law of Moses in the Torah. Second, Islam is not consistent with Judaism. It shares nothing but a jealousy to possess what Judaism rightfully has, a covenant with the God of Abraham, and possession of the holy city of Jerusalem. You wrote, the fruits of the prophet, that's a strong fact against Paul and Christianity. Simply wrong, brother. Paul healed the sick, and Paul taught the word of God, and God endorsed him with signs and miracles. Paul was called by the Messiah under miraculous and detailed circumstances, which showed God's planning. Christianity spread in the face of persecution by the strongest superpower of the day, Rome. Christianity grew by 5,000 within a few months of the crucifixion and resurrection of Yeshua the Messiah. Islam grew by dozens, maybe 150 after 10 years in Mecca. And there was little to no persecution for following Muhammad. Only after jihad and war and violence could Muhammad cause his religion to grow past 1,000. That's a strong fact against Muhammad and his religion, Muhammadism. You wrote, according to Judaism, Christianity is bad and satanic. History plays a role in shaping such opinions, including the Christians fleeing Jerusalem while millions of Jews died. Yeshua warned the believers, the Christians, and they obeyed and were saved. If you want God to warn you, listen and obey when he does. According to Judaism, on the other side, Islam is good and perfect monotheism. Again, attempting to use alleged Jewish opinions is useless cherry-picking, brother. I have no respect for claiming the position of a source you do not respect. When the one deity a religion worships is Thor, Zeus, Satan, or a rock, monotheism means nothing, brother. This is not such a hard concept to grasp, yet Satan has used it successfully against those following Muhammad. Following the wrong deity and blindly claiming it alone is the one true deity is worthless. The God of the Jews and Christians is indeed one God, Echad, united in purpose, one in unity. Yeshua the Messiah said, "The Father and I are one." You cannot honor God the Father unless you first honor God the Son. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.